senior technical consultant at AWS in Bangalore. So a brief introduction about me. I have total 20 years of IT experience, and I started my career as a developer in VB, Visual Basic, and then I started learning Java. And for a long time I wanted to learn machine learning, trust me, because I am not, like, how many are you from engineering background? Wow, great, so it must be very easy for you guys. So I am from human genetics, microbiology and biochemistry. And what I do at Amazon is that I am an evangelist, whatever the new technology comes in. So I do lot of POCs, and I wrote lot of public articles and lot of, like, working prototypes which are available in Twitter and even in public Amazon website. So today, telling you, sharing you my experience. Like, 5 years back, I wanted to learn machine learning. At that time, Python, R, it was like so scary. But now look at the way the technology is transforming, right? So you don't have to really go into that data scientist kind of stuff to write a machine learning. Anybody can do coding today, right, in machine learning. How many of you agree with that? It is much easier, right? So earlier it was a barrier, now it's much easier. So let's see where we stand today in the industry and how AWS is, like, you know, helping the customers to move from, as she's mentioned, like, you know, idea to implementation. So we'll look at some of the new technologies which are launched in 2019 reInvent and how they are going to help you and customers to accelerate the speed. So this is the customer base which AWS has. So you can look at the number of customers, right? So it's like tens of thousands of workloads and more than twice as many workloads than any other customer workbase. So this is huge. Like, lot of customers are using this, like, you know, to predict before you get a heart attack. 15 months before that they are predicting, like, sensor. They are using this machine learning, SageMaker, machine learning, deep learning to predict that. And, you know, even Redbus in India, they are using machine learning, like, you know, SageMaker predictions to predict what kind of, you know, tickets will be purchased next and what is the suggestions we should make to the user. So they are becoming more and more popular. So just a brief about what is the footprint of AWS. So moving on to the next slide, but the journey has only begun. So why we are saying the journey has only begun is, if you see, machine learning was there for almost 50 years in the industry, but the adaptation was not so high. But if you look at now, so it's almost making an impact in every industry. Because, can you guess why? Because of the cloud. So cloud is making easy to scale. And the adoption, like, from peripheral, it is becoming one of the core area of almost all the industries. So we are just in the beginning, like, because, you know, the data and the compute capacity is becoming more and more available and reliable because of the cloud technologies. So it's, like, easy for anybody to go for a machine learning just, you know, within minutes, like within hours, to actually deploy something in production. Let's look at how, you know, that is going to happen. So there are like, you know, plenty of examples in the history if you take. So how the things have changed. For example, in olden days, in 1826 is the first photograph which was taken, and it took 150 years to actually come up with a digital camera. So what was the challenge there? You need to have someone who is skilled in taking the photograph and who can actually handle the equipment, right? So then they will be able to take the photograph. I don't know how many of you are in your 40s or 50s. If you take the photo, you have to take the camera roll and get it and developed, and then you will know it's overexposed or it's not good. But if you see right now what is happening, if you see Instagram or Facebook, everybody is posting so many photos and they are so good as if they are taken by professionals. So what is the difference here? What do you think is the difference here? So the skill barrier is not there. Earlier you need someone with special skills to do that, but now the skill barrier has completely taken out by including the advanced camera capabilities in your phones. So that's what is happening, right? So machine learning in the hands of the developers. At AWS, what we think is that building something is not great, but how do we scale it and how do we make it more and more available to the customers and the, you know, developers? So I don't know how many of you have seen the Deep Racer, or last year they released Deep Composer. It's like literally you are putting the machine learning in the hands of the developers, so you can do whatever you want. So some of the challenges, like if you see some of the challenges, as I mentioned, why machine learning is one of the, you know, considered one of the toughest thing to learn, because it's a skill gap. Because, you know, if you see the mindset is that people should be data scientists and they have to know all about the models and scientific algorithms to do the machine learning. So that's a major problem. And if you see, and it's not just an easy task, you have to create the model, test it with multiple data sets, and find which data sets to suit your needs, and then go to production. It's a time-consuming and complex task which involves a lot of resources. And finding the right business case to solve the right problem. So these are the, some of the challenges. So this is the AWS machine learning stack. Wherever you see new is launched in 2019. How this helps developers from creating or building to training to deploying the models. So we'll look at each of these layers. So in a core, if you look at, like, you know, what we are going to focus is easier to build. So if you see easier to build earlier, So easier to build is like you don't need a special skill to build. You don't need a special language to write the code. Easier to scale. Like you are, okay, you are doing some experimentation. How can I go into production within, like I want to take the idea to production. So how can I take it very fast, very smoothly, efficiently, and easier to apply. So like out of box models. I don't want to build something. It's already there. For example, recognition or a speech. So you just use it. You don't have to reinvent the wheel. So let's see how this map to the stack, AWS stack. So easier to build. These are the frameworks on which the core people, like the developers, develop the machine learning algorithms. We have Kendras, Gluon, TensorFlow, PyTorch, right? So how many of you did coding in Java? Great. So you know, right, like there are a lot of Java developers in the market. In 2004, after that, Java became very popular. And but now, the machine learning choice is Python. So, but still organizations has developed so much code in Java, do you think they will simply move out of Java and go to Python? Is that journey so easy? It will take time, right? And if the organization wants to go to that, it takes a long journey, and also they have to train their employees to learn Python if they want to go to machine learning, keep up with the market and the competition, and the developers has to learn Python, and if they don't learn Python, they have to understand the Python code and convert the Python code into Java. Is that easy? So, have you heard about DJL? Deep Java library. So this is a new introduction by AWS. So this gives the flexibility of developers. You don't need to learn Python. You can still write your Java code and develop machine learning and deep learning models using Java code. It's a simple Java API. And it's also provides models for prototyping to accelerate and simplify the development. So this is very easy, right? I don't have to learn Java, I don't have to learn Python. I can still write code, and I'm still writing the code in machine learning code. So what that gives you, because you can participate as a developer, you can participate in this machine learning revolution, right? And it is very easy, you are comfortable, you know Java, you are writing Java for a long time. Use that and write machine learning code. And what happened at Amazon is they wanted to test how this is going to work, and they were talking to a lot of internal teams. And when they were talking to one of the team, forecast team, who uses the machine learning in Java exclusively for forecasting in their supply chain what is the demand, so they were using it. And what the data scientist will do is they'll write the code in Python and they will give it to the infrastructure team who is using Java to deploy. And it was a headache for Java developer to read the code, understand the code, translate the code, and deploy the code. So by introducing this DJL, they reduced 30% of the time because they can do all that using their native Java libraries. Another popular language, so SQL. Almost all developers, I'm assuming, know SQL, and almost all data scientists know SQL, and almost all the business analysts know SQL, right? SQL structured query language. Why? Because all the data which is coming for the data science resides in the tables or the files, Excel files. That is the source, right, for machine learning. Can you expect them to learn Python and Java and write code? So I don't know, if you are working for an enterprise, there will be a business analyst team who want to write the query to fetch the data and do some analysis. It's not very easy because, you know, you have to write the model and they have to extract the data and then they will get the results. So let's see how that, you know, machine learning is incorporated in database driven application. So what you have to do as a scientist, first you have to select the model, train the model, write the application, and then modify the data to suit the model, like tune the data, right? And then call the ML services and then, you know, load the data, like get the output and load the data into the application. So this is a time consuming and a lengthy process, 6 steps. So what happened is there is a new service introduced again by AWS in 2019. So which gives direct access. You can directly write the SQL queries without any integration required to integrate with SageMaker and Comprehend. Like you can use Aurora. Aurora is the RDS database service. So you can write queries to query the data from Comprehend and, you know, SageMaker, and you can use Athena. Athena is one more query like editor. You can get the data from SageMaker and you can use QuickSight. QuickSight is a reporting dashboard. You can directly integrate with SageMaker. So all these things are making it easy for the developers to adopt. So what is happening? We are making the build process very easy for the developers, right? So you are not learning something new. You are developing on what you have already, your core areas or your strong areas. So you are more productive and you are more efficient. That means the organizations are not wasting time in training the employees or spending infrastructure cost of maintaining two environments. So from 6 steps, what happens is it will come down to 3 steps. Basically, you will select the model if it is already there, or you will write the write the model and write the query and get the data. Simple. From 6 steps to 3 steps, without any integration, without any time, like, you know, long time taken to do testing and modify the data set and all this stuff. How this works? So if you see, this is an example, like what happens is that you are writing a trigger in the first one. So if there is a transaction, is a fraud transaction, drop the transaction, roll back the transaction. And if you are like, you know, that is using the SageMaker. And the second one is using the Comprehend sentiment analysis. If there is a negative sentiment, I want to know. So it's very easy, right? You are simply writing the query. See the language, it's a SQL language. So so what is happening here is that when you are under the hood, what happens? So when the application is making a call, so you can think, right, machine learning means there is a lot of data. How it is happening on the fly so fast when I'm writing the SQL queries? So when application makes a call, it's actually more than, you know, 10 times more than what you have right now. And it groups the data, batches the data, and it sends the request. It gets the response back to the application. And you know the concept of pagination, right? Again, it makes a request for next, like grouping. I'm just taking an example of 25 here. So that's how it works. So before we go here, like, I want to tell you how it works, like, okay. So you understood this process, right? So it's easier, like, now what we are doing in the build, easier to build, we drop the skill barrier of language. So language is one of the main concern of the developers to develop the machine learning code. So we are dropping it by introducing DJL, and we are introducing queries to directly query some of the machine learning models to take the data and integrate the data back in the application. and easier to scale. What it means by easier to scale? So when you develop something, it's an experimentation. How can I take it to the mass level for organizations and how they can improve the developer's efficiency, right? For example, if you take any developer, they are very comfortable developing using their standard tools and processes. They know, okay, this is how I have to collaborate. These are the coding standards I have to follow, and this is how I check in my code. I run my unit test cases, I'll get the results. So that's what is happening, right? But if you look at the traditional machine learning models, how many of they give profilers, compilers, and debuggers? Compilers, obviously, they give profilers, debuggers, and how many of them provide transparency, visibility, and full management? Like, you don't have to take care of the infrastructure management. How many of them they provide? So that's the reason SageMaker Studio ID has been developed. So it has a built-in algorithms and notebooks, and you can do a lot of experimentation, and it will give you the models. You can select what is the best model, and you can make a trade-off, and you can go to production. So let's see what that means. So when you are actually writing the machine learning, the main challenge is you have to first analyze the data, right? And you have to select the algorithm. And what are the parameters you have to set? Algorithm settings and the hyperparameters to get the best output. So what you will do, end up doing is you keep on changing the parameters, algorithms to get what you want. Then you will select what you want. Then you will say, okay, this will fit my business case. But how long that will take? Even for an expert, how long that will take? That takes time, right? So what happened in the past was, companies had two choices. Either you hire somebody who is experienced in-house and they can do all this, like, you know, machine learning, hard coding stuff. So you will have access to full, you know, you will, because the organization has to comply to security and all these reasons, like, you know, all the trade-offs, like fully controllable, auditable, and you will have the code. Or you can go for automated models. Automated models are like black box. You are using it, but you don't know what is happening inside. And you don't have control to stop it, or you don't have control to provide any inputs to it, right? So now you have a third option. It's an autopilot. Amazon SageMaker autopilot. So we will discuss more about this, what it does. So it what it does is that, you know, I'm just going to the next slide, so I'll explain better. So autopilot works best with Excel-like data or table-like data. That's your machine learning data, right? Basically all about the data. So what happens when you actually, you can point to a Excel file or a database and you point to a column, it will find out what is the problem to solve. You're not telling it what is the problem to solve. It will find out. If it is a sequential numerical data, it will use automatically regression model. And if it is a classification like yes or no, true or false, it will use binary classification model. So it automatically does that. And not only that, after selecting the model and the problem to solve, it normalizes the data. So one hot encoding for all this kind of, you know, category columns, and numerical encoding, like, you know, normalization for numerical columns, TF2, IF text columns, all that conversion it will take care. And then it will select the hardware, and it will select the algorithm, and what are the settings for the algorithm, and what should be the parameters. And then it will generate the notebooks with the commented code. So you can look at it and to see what is happening. And it will give you all the notebooks later. If you wish to modify the code, you can modify, and at any point of time you can stop, you can provide inputs, and you can run the code, or you can just let it run and take the inputs, or you can stop it and give the inputs. So what is happening here is, the difference is, if you are going for automated machine learning models, you don't have control over it. You can't stop it, you can't modify it, and it will not have access to the full data set. Let's say you want to add another parameter. So it has already analyzed something, but you want to add another parameter, you can't do it. But here you will get full flexibility to do that. So you can see the specify the column, and it will identify the problem. So that's what we talked about. So under the hood what is happening. So I'm just telling you what happens. So when you're actually pointing to a tabular data in Excel or a database, so it will identify what is the problem to solve. And then it will generate a candidate notebook with 7 trials. And it will use Bayesian optimizer to generate 250 models and train. So automatically, everything happens parallelly. And then it will give you the dashboard with the predictions. So what happens, another problem with automated machine learning models is, so you will never know latency over optimization, like, you know, accuracy. For example, 200 milliseconds latency, is that better than 1% accuracy? Can it make a decision? It's very difficult, right? Whatever is a millisecond, like, you can take only one parameter, so that's a problem. So this is how it will look. So it will give you the options. So it will run 250 models and it will give you the options. So which one will you choose? 95% accuracy with double the latency or 93% accuracy with half the latency? You will definitely go for the second one, right? So that's the advantage of it. So what happened? We had all these things. So like now the process has become, earlier also you were selecting the data, parameters, algorithm. So now it has all been combined and you are getting the transparency and you are actually, you know, automatically it is doing it for you, SageMaker Autopilot, and you have the full freedom and flexibility to stop and provide inputs. So, okay, fine. So in the easier to scale, we discussed so far how we can easily identify the models and develop it. But now the challenge is how I am going to take it to the production, right? So anything to take it to the production is a challenging, because you need to do a lot of orchestration and that's not easy. And even for data scientists, it's not easy, trust me. So there are multiple orchestration frameworks available. I hope you might have heard, like whoever is working already on machine learning, Kubeflow, Airflow, MLflow. But is that enough? Because orchestration is enough. Do you think it is enough? So as an organization, what you need to do? You have to maintain the infrastructure. You have to be worried about the cost and performance, security, compliance, high availability, fault tolerance. All these are overheads, right? So that's all has to be taken care of if you go for any of these models, right? That all has to be managed by someone. But what happens is SageMaker now integrates with Kubeflow. So that means it's automatically integrated. It will take fully managed. So it will take care of whatever we talked about, optimization, cost, security, compliance, high availability, fault tolerance. So that's the advantage of, you know, integrating with Kubeflow with SageMaker. So you can easily go to production without having to worry about all these headaches. So then in the last layer, we are talking about easier to apply. This is where all the AI services come in picture. So you might have seen the recognition, face recognition, poly, speech, lot of things, right? So there are some more new services got added like Kendra, fraud detector, and code guru. So I will just briefly touch upon what they are actually, how we can use them. So the main advantage of easier to apply is that you are not building anything. Whatever is there out of the box, you are applying. So we discussed how build is making it easier, how scale it making easier, and how application is making it easier. Application is, you are not doing any development. The models are already there, tested with lot of data. You are just using APIs to integrate with your application. So, like even in your organization, if you are searching something internally, how many times you get the results, what you expect? Because if you are searching something, because the reason is that data is disjointed, right? You have wiki systems, like file-based systems, you have Dropbox, you have databases and SharePoint, and if you have a cloud, you have S3. So the data is scattered. How these systems are jointed, like is there any join between them so that it will go and find out where to find the data and give me the results? It's very difficult, right? So the key challenge is the data is unstructured. Right now, all the searches are keyword searches. It's not a question. How can I do this? My laptop is broke. Where can I find this? It's not like that. You just need a keyword and it will do a search based on the keyword. Wherever the keyword is found, you will get all the results. As said, the data is scattered and difficult to set up. So any organization, if they want to set up a system where they go and search all their internal systems, it is very difficult. So what, there is a new service, AI service. It's out of box service, you can just start using it. It's called Kendra. It's introduced in 2019. So what happens is that, you know, easier to find your what you're looking for and simple and quick to set up. So it's not something like text-based search. It's like you can even speak to it. You can write, my laptop is broke. Or where can I apply for this? I want to apply for a leave. You can just, you know, say or type the word. And it also maintains a machine, like, you know, a memory of it. Like it applies machine learning models. Like, for example, I am making a search. What kind of searches I have done to give me the answers better suits for me. So that's the advantage of new ways of searching. So, and also it provides a single plane of glass. For example, you have multiple mail systems and it will give you, like, you have a corporate mail, for example, you are working for customers, you will have a separate email ID, so you can configure everything in one place and you will get all the answers in one place. It's basically, it's not like they're not treating employees like a employee, it's like a consumer, like end user. So they are giving a very high five and all the, like, you know, very easy to use access kind of system. So that's how it looks like, to know CEO, what is happening, all the notifications, everything in one day. So what is the quality of a good natural language assistant? So these are the four qualities, right? Natural language assistant is basically your chatbots or whatever. So what basically it need to do is, it need to perform a task which you're asking it to do. It has to be intelligent, like it has to have the memory of what you asked previously, and it has to have work in the context of what you are asking and who is asking. It has to personalize. And it also has to have the knowledge, like from different sources, and it should not be boring, right? Basically, if it is boring, nobody will use it. So AI in the workplace, AI is just in the middle of it. The reason I'm showing like this is that you have a machine learning, vision, natural language processing, speech, all these are integrated. Like if you see machine learning, you have a deep learning, reinforcement learning, supervised learning and unsupervised learning. And if you have a vision, like machine vision and image recognition, and natural language, like you have text to speech, speech to text kind of stuff, and all these things are related to artificial intelligence. So that's how AI is playing a major role in our workplace, because AI is easy to use, right? You are just integrating, like artificial intelligence, all the tools are out of box. And you can call the APIs and integrate with it. So this is what I was telling, search is changing. It's not like a keyword search, it's based on questions, and ML-based search. Advanced NLP can understand the user even better. So when you're asking something, it will take the emotions into action. So for example, if you see like even Amazon, like we have a recognition, face recognition, it will identify the face emotions. Is it a negative emotion or a positive emotion? Are you angry, upset, happy? Then it will change the whole speech. And voice is on the rise. Obviously, nobody wants to type anything right now. So if even people want to call, they will say, call somebody like that. So this is how Kendra goes to gym. Just an example, what time gym opens. So if you see, it will give you I think it's cropping it over here, it will give you the answer like this. So it's actually finding all the, you know, relevant answers for that. It's not just throwing you the hyperlinks. That's a difference. So answers are not links. Answers plus action is equal to assistance. So that's how the industry is changing, right? If you think about search, this is how it is going to be in the future. So another example is your code pipeline. So if you are writing the code, what you will do? You will write the code, somebody has to test it, and first of all, before testing, they have to review, and you have to test, deploy, measure, and improve. So what is missing here? So you have to ask somebody to do a code review. They will give you a suggestion. You will fix the code. It may not be 100% because person is doing the review. and they may not tell you, like, you know, it's not possible to find out what is the costly code. You might be writing something which is actually very costly or which has a lot of garbage in it. So it's very difficult to tell because the person is doing the review. Even if you write the test case again, the person is doing the test cases. So one more example, so it is giving you the fix. Don't use the synchronized object, use a different alternative. And pagination, it is saying you are using this get item, so it needs a next tokenizer, so you are missing that, apply that. So okay, you are fixing it. And sensitive information leak. So how many times manually a person can review, right? Like for example, you are getting the AWS account ID and you are using exception as he has access to everything, right? And you can e.print, everything will come. So it is giving a suggestion, don't do that, use this kind of option. So that's in brief, like we touched about, how just it's easier to build using lowering the expertise skill level required by providing DGL and, you know, SQL based queries, and easier to scale by providing SageMaker, autopilot, so you don't have to maintain any infrastructure. It will develop the models, it will give you the options, you select it, and later it will give you the notebooks, you can modify it, and in fact you can pause and give the inputs, and easier to apply. You have all this at AI tools available which are out of box. Just pick and choose whatever you want to use and apply. So this is how the India, like, you know, these are the problems which we see across the industries, and these are the offerings like made by AWS to make it easy for the developers and companies to scale. So yeah, I think I am done, pretty much done. I think I am ahead of time. Thank you guys, thank you for your time.